ॐ नमो भगवते श्री रमणाय ॐ नमो भगवते श्री रमणाय ॐ नमो भगवते prostrations to Bhagavan Sri Ramana Maharshi, who has come in so many forms to bless us all. Prostrations to Pujya Papaji, prostrations to Pujya Mataji, prostrations to Swami Sachidananda Ji. It's a great blessing on me that I could continue to talk on Pujya Mataji today also. She is a living idol in my heart. A saint, a dictionary defines, is a person of deep compassion and great sacredness. I am sure those who have been blessed to be with Mataji and serve her should have felt this intensely in Mataji. As I shared yesterday, Mataji's compassion is vaster than the ocean. Vaster, usually vaster than the ocean means ocean has limitations, any ocean. World's biggest ocean, I am told, is Pacific Ocean, but it has also borders. A saint's compassion has no borders at all. You cannot pinpoint, this is how she will be, this is how he will be. Otherwise, can you imagine? I was in Varanasi with a vow to stay there for a year. In the seventh month, perhaps it is September, end of September 1988 or beginning of October 1988, I became so restless in that serene atmosphere of the banks of Ganges, serene atmosphere of the great modern sage Jai Krishnamurti. And I was living in the midst of the old devotees of Jai Krishnamurti. Satsang was always there. It was so peaceful. I was translating the tapes of Jai Krishnamurti for the first time. Not that I was the first person to translate. There was somebody who used to take 3 months, 6 months to translate one cassette. And he was also giving trouble to the institution. Somehow there was an intuition in me to start, go and ask the management, can I do the transcription? They were first hesitant, because the first person has given them trouble and has been giving them trouble. I said, I need only a cassette recorder and a typewriter in my room. Within a day, first day, I transcribed, typed, prepared the first cassette. I'm not trying to boast myself that I did some service. I was so thrilled because for the first time I am hearing the great master J. Krishnamurti's that particular talk, and went and submitted to the management. They were so surprised because the previous man was dragging them for 4 months, 6 months just to have one cassette transcribed. And without a tinge of ego, I'm telling you, I transcribed nearly 70 cassettes. I got it direct from the master. This is how I am sharing this again, not to boast about me. How God will guide you directly from Krishnamurti's. Krishnamurti had left 1986. His body. I am doing it there, 1988, his cassettes, and direct to his voice, his communication. And then Bhagavan used to say, and of course all of you may know, writing once is equivalent to reading 10 times or 100 times, they used to say. So I was typing, and then it is 10 times for me to, as if to read blessings, blessings. Once used, as Ramana said, once you get into the escalator, is it escalator? Escalator, there is no stopping. It will carry you further, 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 further. A sage is not a body. There is no difference between Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, Ramana Maharshi, Papa Ramdas, Mataji Krishnaba, J. Krishnamurti. Only when you look at the body, they are all different. Look at the teaching. The truth. Teaching is nothing but truth. Mataji, in her last instructions, when she was saying that your guru, your Sadguru is Bhagavan Sri Ramana Maharshi, and Ganeshan, your path is self-inquiry. She specifically told me, the guru is the teaching, he is not the teacher. Just because he gives you the teaching, just for convenience sake, we labeled him as a teacher. But the real teacher is the sage's teaching only. So she insisted that I follow Maharshi's teaching of put into practice, as I shared yesterday. He practically guided me. Before doing self-inquiry, keep a picture of Bhagavan, go and prostrate to the Bhagavan, and then chant Ramana, 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 Ramana a few times and sit for meditation. Very practical guidance. So from Varanasi, and see how Mataji has been thinking about me, because that's what Satchiananda Swami said. For past 1 week, from morning and evening, Satchiananda, Yava, Ganesha Varam, Illa Mataji, Ganesha Alla Varamudiyadu, our Mangalore mental hospital, what a golden day, Ganesha Vara, Ganesha Vara. So I was taken to the presence of Mataji, as I said, shared yesterday. And then I saw Mataji in that dilapidated condition, lying down with just a white sheet covering her body. Of course, Satchiananda Swami bent down to Mataji, Mataji, pardon me, I did not understand. Then also Mataji told Satchiananda Swami, staying in the state of learning, always, never come to the state I know. Always be in the state of learning the thought that I know. That prevents us from progress. At least when we are in the presence of a saint, we should humble ourselves. That's why Ramana Maharshi in Who Am I, the only ethical sentence he wrote was Guru Swalpudi Nadaka Vendum. One has to abide by the commandment of the Guru. So I came, I couldn't see Mataji's body condition. I cried. She said, child, she understood my state of mind. Child, stay here. Go and rest. Come tomorrow early morning here and sit on a stool that I put for you. She was lying down. She said, I want to be seeing you. This darshan hour, every day you should come and sit here. That was the greatest boon. One of the greatest boons I have received as a spiritual aspirant from sages, saints, particularly from Mataji. Every day she will stay on. She did not stay here for 2 months, but that's the beauty. Now when I recollect, the mind wants, how long should I stay here? These are all management problems, not a saint's problem. We should be every moment alert, not to think of when to leave, plan 15 days afterwards, nothing. You should be in a state of fluidity, that's what they say. There was another sage who was living in Uttarkashi, who put a condition. When I wanted to go and stay with him, I will put you 2 conditions. You should not even think about going back to Ramanashram. And never ask me when you should leave. Though it may look at that moment an irritant proposition, otherwise a slavish condition, that's only for our development. Because otherwise our mind will go to the time consciousness. Tomorrow, 15 days afterwards, next week, we are already the slaves of time. That's the only condition under which we suffer. We think time is very important. That's for the worldly matters. In spiritual matters, it is immaterial, whether it is daytime or nighttime. When Ramana Maharshi was in Virupaksha cave, somebody talking to the other said, it's 4 o'clock, because that person was having a watch. Bhagavan just perhaps wanting to teach him, Kartala Nalumaniya, Sahindra Nalumaniya. Is it morning 4 o'clock or evening 4 o'clock? That upadesa for that person, I took it to heart. Never think about this is morning, this is noon, this is evening, this is night. If you are in the presence of the master, or master is master's teaching, if you are practicing the teaching or following the master's instruction, like you have to do the japa of Om Sri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram, those who practice this will experientially know what I am sharing with you. There is no time limit there at all. Before starting the japa, you might look at the watch. Then you end the japa, you may look at the watch, but remember, experience yourself while doing the japa, while doing whatever your sadhana may be. You can never be conscious of time. If you are conscious of time, then you are not doing japa or your sadhana. And Murugannar once explained this to me. Will you believe a person, I am sleeping, if somebody says, I am in deep sleep, don't disturb me, he is not sleeping. He doesn't, he is awake. If he is not awake, he cannot say, I am in deep sleep. So seekers should be, this is a very helpful sharing. Never wear a watch. I did not wear a watch up to the age of 60. Somebody thrust it on me. Now I am addicted to watch. That's the problem. Once you get the external things, it becomes an addiction. So Mataji, stay. Every morning she said, come and sit where I put your seat. So the next morning I went, already there was a corridor like thing, devotees were waiting, there was only 1 hour darshan of Mataji, when men, women, all of them would queue and then have darshan of her and move out. Mataji put a stool for me with a cushion inside that corridor, while lying down she could see me. So when I went, every morning I will go, she will take my head on her heart and then bless me, sit down. Stay today, stay, stay here, not today, she did not use the word today, stay, take rest. Every day for 2 months, she was saying the same thing in the morning, stay, take rest. These are the two instructions. Then the first day, as I shared yesterday, I had a thought to ask her, what should I do, seated here? She read my thought, child, you need not do anything, be observing, looking at me and observing whatever is taking place around. Maybe at that time I did not understand why she told me that. But as the days were going, every day morning I will go and prostrate to her. She will stay, stay, take rest. Kodanda, iru. Rest of the body. So one day, I want to share. I believe in sharing. Sharing is not a teaching. That's why I always tell my gatherings, I am not a teacher, I am not a guru, but I have got something to share with you. Which old devotees had shared with me. In sharing, it is always 50-50. In teaching, I am 70, you are 30. Or if you are arrogant, I won't listen to you, you are 70, I am 30. But in sharing, it always goes smoothly. It is helpful to you. It's not an instruction, do this, but you will start doing it. That's how I did in my life. So I was observing every day. It was so peaceful, so powerful, Mataji's presence. One day, a youth came from Bangalore. Though everyone would be prostrating, Mataji would be nodding her head or whatever sign, they will be moving out. But in certain cases, Mataji will look at me, whether I have observed. So this youth, young boy, was one among them. Mataji looked at me. That I understood, I should keenly observe. He told Mataji, I have come with my mother I am in Bangalore. I am not married. I recently read a newspaper article on Anandashram. There I found out Mataji is giving Mantra Diksha. I am totally devoted to Mantra Diksha. So Mataji, I have come here to take Mantra Diksha from you. Have you already received the Mantra Diksha? She asked. Yes, from our family guru. There is a Brahmin boy, perhaps an Ambudri, I don't know. And he said, from our family guru, I got initiated. In what mantra were you initiated? Mataji asked. He said, Narayana mantra. Om Namo Narayanaya. And then that initiated guru advised me to continuously chant and get absorbed into it. I was doing it for months and months, but I did not get any effect. But I am keen only, my sadhana, I have chosen only mantra, chanting mantra, no other mode of sadhana. So Mataji, I want you humbly, I request you, please give me a fresh mantra which will work on me. Mataji looked at me and smiled. She said, ask Sachidananda, somebody else. So Sachidananda Swami came. Tomorrow I am going to initiate this boy. Because that was the time when Mataji was not initiating anybody. So the next day I was very curious, curious in the sense, really happily waiting. This fellow has already done Narayana mantra and failed, and asked Mataji to give a fresh mantra. And what is going to happen? That boy looked very sincere. He is not a half-assed boy, he looked very sincere. So the next day I also came, and Sachidananda Swami had prepared how to initiate, and I was very keen. Mataji told that boy, bend down. Now I am very, very particular about it. The mantra that I am going to initiate you should repeat it with greatest devotion, with greatest attention, without getting diverted from that. He said, yes, Mataji, I will do. I am going to chant 3 times. And you have to repeat every time that I repeat. And that boy was also very eagerly waiting. I was also eagerly waiting. Come closer to me, bend down. And then the boy bent down. Om Namo Narayanaya. I tell you honestly, I did not have a thought. Oh, this is what that boy was already initiated, did not come. And I watched that boy. There was not a ripple of repulsion or rejection of that, even in the thought form. He was so devoted, he was so absorbed that he was listening to Om Namo Narayanaya. The first time he chanted it back, and Mataji, second time, my child, repeat it, Om Namo Narayanaya. And when second time he chanted, that boy, automatically his eyes closed. And the third time when Mataji said, repeated Om Namo Narayanaya, that boy went into ecstasy chanting Om Namo Narayanaya. For 10 minutes or 15 minutes, with closed eyes, he was in ecstasy. I observed this. I was also in ecstasy. There was not a thought crossing in my mind. This is the same mantra he was given. On the other hand, see, this is Guru's grace. Guru will always guide you. And when this was taking place, in my heart, I remembered 2 other instances only. similar instances. So it was supportive of this, not objecting to this or rejecting this. You all know Kanchi Shankaracharya, Paramacharya. One Natukottai Chettiar in the south Tamil Nadu. Chettiars, Natukottai Chettiars are very wealthy people. One Natukottai Chettiar came to Shankaracharya and told him, "Swami, I have been initiated by our one Swami, Sanyasi, into Om Namah Shivaya. I have been doing it very faithfully, but it did not help me at all. No progress, nothing was there." So there was another Swami who came, and to him also, I went and asked, he also gave me the same Om Namah Shivaya. And I did it sincerely, but I did not get any result. So, Swami, I have come to you. Please initiate my path is only chanting the Nama. I am not drawn to any other form of sadhana. So please initiate me. Paramacharya told him, "Come tomorrow. I will initiate you." And this Chettiar was hoping. And then with great devotion he came the next day. This was reported to me by an eyewitness. And the next day when the Chettiar came, all the ritualistic way of initiation, step by step, was taken place. And then Paramacharya chanted in his ears, "Om Namah Shivaya." The Chettiar repeated that. Paramacharya also repeated it 3 times. By the 3rd time, when the Chettiar chanted that mantra, he went into ecstasy. This I remembered when this boy got the Narayana mantra, and also I immediately remembered in talks with Maharshi, there is a passage where Ramana Maharshi was asked, this is all taking place in the presence of Mataji. So it is not just a thought, something coming up from within. There, a devotee asks Bhagavan, "Can anyone initiate anyone else into mantra? Will it be valid?" Ramana Maharshi said, "No. It won't be valid. Mantra initiation should be done only by a competent person to the other." Then Bhagavan condescends, "I will tell you a story." In that talks, reply of Bhagavan, it comes. He tells this story. There was a king and a faithful prime minister for him, serving him very sincerely. The king was a young man, the minister was an old man, and he was faithfully doing all his duties, totally devoted to the king, but every weekend he will disappear, just for one day. He will go to the forest and be with a Swamiji there and then come back. The rest of the days, 6 days, he will be working tremendously hard. This the king observed. This is the one thing, everything the minister will come and report to the king. Only what he does on that particular day, he was not reporting to the king. But the king, being very curious, he comes to know, perhaps through the spies, that he goes to the forest to a sannyasi, and that sannyasi had initiated him into Gayatri mantra, this minister, and that sannyasi had told him he should chant it very sincerely in his presence. So that's why even without telling me a thing, he was going there and every day doing. Then afterwards, the next day, when the minister came, the king asked, "I know where you are going and what you are doing there. You are so sincere to me. Why are you hesitant to tell that to me?" And if it, he said, "Master, O king, it is very sacred. It is not secret. It is very, very sacred for me. I am holding it in my heart so very dearly. I know what you have learned from that sannyasi, Gayatri Mantra. I am not able to go to that sannyasi. Why don't you initiate me into Gayatri Mantra since you are so sincerely doing that?" The minister told him, "I am not the proper person to initiate you. Even if I initiate you, it will not work." Then the king ignored the minister and asked some pandit to give him the Gayatri Mantra. And that pandit gave the king the Gayatri Mantra, and the king was chanting and he did not get it, because the king, the minister's face used to be radiant. And here, he chanting for 1 or 2 days Gayatri Mantra, it was not working. So the next day, he called the minister. "See, I am your king. I am ordering you. You have to initiate me into Gayatri Mantra." He said, "Dear king, it has to be initiation has to be given by a competent person. I am not competent enough to initiate you. You are defying my order." Then the king, the minister thought, any amount of explanation is not going to clear the doubt of the king. So there was a soldier, bodyguard of the king, standing there. So he called him, he is prime minister, he said, "Hey, come here, arrest this king." And that fellow froze. He did not arrest the king. The king got wild. "You are not only disobeyed me, you are not initiating me, you have this arrogance to say, arrest me? Hey, page," he called page, they called the soldiers page. "Hey, page, arrest the minister." Immediately he came and arrested the prime minister. Then the prime minister smiled and laughed. The king said, "Instead of repenting, why are you smiling or laughing?" "See, king, the same word I used to the same person, I said, arrest him. It did not work, he did not do that. But you said the same word, arrest him. The moment, the next moment, he has put handcuffs in my hand, even though I am the prime minister. He must have power. You have power, I do not have power to arrest you." Then the king, the Bhagavan refers to this in the talks with Maharshi, narrates this king and then says, a person should be competent. There was another incident which Kunji Swami, these are all I am recollecting in the presence of Mataji. And then another thing came up. Kunji Swami once told me about a very, very great saintly medicinal man in Kerala, Dr. Moose. That Dr. Moose was not only an Ayurvedic doctor, he was treated like a saint in his place, in his whatever the country or village or town. He even came when Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi was affected with cancer. He was called for and he examined Bhagavan and then prostrated to Bhagavan and then told the doctors and the management, we Ayurvedic physicians, we can only attend to and cure diseases of human beings. Ramana Maharshi is a jnani and we have no power to operate on jnani. Jnani has no body, and we do not have any control over that body. That was that Dr. Moose, because immediately after that, Kunji Swami was alone with Bhagavan. Bhagavan told him, Dr. Moose is a man of knowledge, Jnanamullavar. Moose and Jnanamullavar said. So that Moose, there was one person from North India. Who was having intense stomachache. He had gone to the Ayurvedic doctors in Gujarat, Maharashtra, in Madhya Pradesh and Bengal, all these, every highest best, because he was a very wealthy man, he could pay very well, travel also comfortably. And everyone, he got disappointed, each doctor, Ayurvedic doctor, and somebody in Calcutta told him, there is Dr. Moose in Kerala, you go and get treated, he will definitely cure you. So that person had come to Dr. Moose, and Dr. Moose asked him, what all medicine, where all you went? And he was so disappointed, that patient. He said, I went to Gujarat, Ayurvedic man. He gave me one Arishta. It did not work. And then I went to the Maharashtra Ayurvedic doctor. He also gave the same Arishta. And it naturally did not work. I came to Calcutta. There was a very big doctor there, Ayurveda doctor. I forget his name. I went to him. After narrating and then his examination, he gave the same Arishta and it did not work. Now, Dr. Moose, I have come to you. I will pay any amount you ask, and I'm suffering too much. And please cure me. Dr. Moose looked at him. I will definitely cure you. If you will take the medicine that I give you, come tomorrow, but you have to stay here for 3 days. Meticulously you have to take this medicine. He said, yes, I agreed. When he came the next day, Dr. Moose himself has prepared the same Arishta. Arishta is a tonic made of herbal, particular herb. So he gave it to him and see the beauty. Dr. Moose told him, I, Dr. Moose, is giving this Arishta to you. When you take it meticulously as I give you instruction, it will be cured within 3 days. But stay and then obey my orders. This patient simply obeyed. Again, this patient did not have a cross thought. This is the same medicine the other doctors also gave. After the third day, his stomach is completely got cured. So then Mataji gave Om Namo Narayanaya mantra. Though a negative thought did not come, these two incidents, what Bhagavan himself said, Ramana Maharshi himself said, and then what Dr. Moose said, gave Maharshi, Mataji should have read my thought. She looked at me. She made this way. Yes, that is it. That is it. So beautiful. Mataji is unimaginably compassionate, unimaginably intelligent. Whatever our intelligence, this intelligence has a limitation. Einstein's intelligence, Bernard Shaw's intelligence, Rabindranath Tagore's intelligence, everything has a limitation. But a saint's intelligence has no borders, no limitation. It will sprout at that moment with whatever problem or whatever issue it is dealing with. And during, this is how I was, every day something or other was happening in the presence of Mataji. And she was guiding me, looking at me and wanting me to observe all that. One day, so I was staying like this, and my friend was like now, Swami Muktananda is my close friend. At that time, Swami Madhurananda was here, and perhaps Mataji or Satchiananda Swami had told him to look after me. So Madhurananda was very, very helpful to me. Only thing he used to ask me is, we none of us know about Ramana Maharshi and Ramana Maharshi's devotees. What happened in the presence of Maharshi? And you have been fortunate enough to know so many old devotees and living there in Ramanashram. Will you please give us anecdotes and also incidents? So I was telling every afternoon in the same room, I will be telling him, narrating to him some incident or other connected with Bhagavan. And it is always very spiritually only, not just factual factual interest, but only spiritual interest. So he was telling to one Shashikala from Secunderabad was staying here, and Madhurananda was, just as he was close to me, he was close to Shashikala also. It seems Shashikala, he told Shashikala whatever every day I was telling. And it was Shashikala at that time when Mataji was sick. She was the only person permitted to feed Mataji the lunch. So one day it seems Shashikala told her, Ganeshanna had told Madhurananda this story. Mataji said, tell me. Because Mataji, as Nachur Ramana said, Mataji used to publicly, openly say, Papa is my father, but Ramana Maharshi is my grandfather. Recently she told me also, same thing. So she was deeply interested. She told Shashikala, you have to come and tell me my grandfather's story. Otherwise I won't eat lunch. You won't believe, after 4 or 5 days, for some reason or other, either I went away or Shashikala went away somewhere, that day there was no story session. Can you believe Mataji refused to eat lunch? Unless my grandfather's story is told to me like a child. Mother was saint can also be a crawling child. See how Jesus Christ has said, unless you become like a suckling baby, you cannot hope to enter the kingdom of God. Mataji was many moments she will become like a suckling baby. So she refused, and then all people, Satchiananda and others, cajoled her to have the lunch with the assurance, from tomorrow onwards Shashikala will definitely come and tell. So Mataji called Shashikala, why do you want to get second hand information? Why don't you get it directly from Ganeshan? But Mataji was very strict also. She told, ask Ganeshan to come to your room and then ask him to narrate, and you in the morning, and you come and tell me that story. Without listening to the story, I will not have lunch. But Mataji had already put Shashikala under strict rule. She should not be looking at males, any male, any man. So Shashikala was hesitant. Then it seems Mataji said, you put the chair this side, looking this side, let Ganeshan in the veranda sit and see this side, and let him narrate, you just listen and come and tell me. This was going on, and Mataji, next day when I go to in the morning, she will make certain signs. Say, yesterday the story was very good, something like that. She will not say this, say the words of appreciation, but when she is blessing, There will be 2-3 more taps on my head. That means I appreciated your story, yesterday's story. At that time, during these story sessions, one of the incidents, Ramana Maharshi told one of the old devotees, that old devotee, perhaps Vishwanatha Swami, asked Bhagavan about diet regulations to Ramana Maharshi. That was the incident that day I was narrating. Bhagavan told him, for a spiritual aspirant, Bhagavan never inflicted upavas, mauna, all that on spiritual aspirants. No ethical disciplines at all, because Bhagavan said openly, self-discipline is the best discipline. Everyone has 2 hands, 2 legs, 2 brain, everything. So you know what is best for you. You have to inflict on you the discipline, not somebody else to put discipline on you. So self-discipline. But Bhagavan that day said, ahara niyamam is very important. Mita ahar, mitas talking, mitas sleep. These 3, Bhagavan told Vishwanatha Swami. Just average limited food, limited talking, not to indulge in continuous talking. That's why many times I feel very guilty, going on for hours, talking about Bhagavan. But still, I console myself, I'm only talking about gurus. I'm not talking about Narendra Modi. So that day, I was sharing this, he told Vishwanatha Swami. When Vishwanatha Swami asked Bhagavan, will you please, because he had come to stay permanently at Ramanashram, the beginning of 1920s and 30s. So he asked, please personally guide me, means the diet regulation. Bhagavan told him, a little bit of rice and rasam is enough for a spiritual aspirant. Rice is to fill up the, take away the hunger. Even though however deep and austere the sadhaka may be, the tongue may demand something. So a little bit of salt, and the body needs a little strength. From the doll, you will get a little strength. For the tongue, there is the salt. So rasam is enough. And Bhagavan added one sentence, everything else added to this for a spiritual aspirant, not for the common man. Everything added to rasam and rice will end up in disease. All our diseases are because of our extra food. We read some books, particularly now internet has come, corrupting everyone. Giving all wrong information about food. But very strict, Bhagavan was very strict for sadhakas, and most of Anandashram Swami, Vishwanatha Swami, Kunji Swami, they were all there staying either inside the ashram or outside the ashram. They will take only rice and rasam. Even in the ashram, when some of these things are served, only rasam and rice they will eat. So that day, Shashikala Ma came and told Mataji this story. Mataji immediately reacted, today I will not have lunch. I will obey my grandfather. Ask the kitchen to make rasam. I will not only today, from today onwards, I will take only rice, sadam and rasam. And she also added, ask the kitchen people to make a bucket full of rasam and distribute it to all. And here Neeru Ma here, somewhere there Neeru, she was a small little girl. Mataji used to say she will always be running after me wherever Madhurananda and myself she will be running after. And Mataji had observed this. And when I go to Mataji, she will also come along with me. So sometimes she will not be there. Mataji will look at me and then ask, Yanga unnoda vaala yanga kaanum? Unnoda vaala kaanume? Vaal means tail. Your tail is missing. So she came and knocked at my door at 2:30 in the afternoon. She had brought, I said, what, Neeru? What is the matter? Because she never comes and disturbs when I will be reading something when I am alone in the room. So what is the matter? No, no, Mataji specifically said, take a tumbler full of rasam, give it to Ganeshan. So I asked, if Mataji has said it's perfect, all right, give it to me, I will drink. Then she narrated to me what all happened in Mataji's place, that everyone in Anandashram, every resident that day, they had at that time 2:30, one cup full of rasam every day. This is the beauty. See, this sharing, some people may think not much about it, but please, this aspect brings about Mataji as the suckling baby. A jnani has many facets. A mahatma has many facets. Like a diamond has many facets. Every facet is important. Because there are so many facets, only the diamond is dazzling. A mahatma or a saint is so great because of the so many facets. And I was staying here, as I said, every day morning, stay, take rest. After that, I was sitting a little pensive mood. Mataji looked at me. She understood, because yesterday, the previous day, I had received an intimation from Ramanashram that Navaratri celebrations were commencing this day, the next day, that they wrote that we would be missing you because from 1960 onwards, that is the time when I settled down at Ramanashram, the Navaratri celebration is the one big celebration that Ramanashram was doing from the days of Bhagavan. Of course, more elaborately, after Bhagavan dropped the body, the idol of Yogambal inside will be taken out in procession around the ashram, and then at a particular place, it will be installed outside the shrine and then worship for 9 days. After the 9th night, again the same idol will be carried in procession and taken back and put installed back at its original place. This is the ritual. And I used to, my teacher T.K. Sundaresiya and another devotee Shastri Mama had specifically instructed me that because I used to be the backbencher, I will go behind. Like Swami Muktananda is always a backbencher, I noticed. So I was also like that. I will not come in front and announce myself, I am the important man here. I will be always behind. So I used to carry, there will be 4 sections of carrying the mother. And I went back and then try to carry it. Both these people came and said, you should not only be the first person in the front side, but on the right hand side. There is spiritual significance, yogic significance for that. So every time I was carrying in the front, at the right side of the pool. All this I was remembering. I am going to miss this time. It was not, I was not regretting. It was just a passing thought. Then I forgot everything about it. In the evening, evening is the time at 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock. That day at Ramanashram, they would be carrying the idol outside and taking in procession. At 4:30 or so, somebody came, maybe Madhurananda came, "Ganeshan, Mataji is calling for you." So I rushed, and before I could go into her room, they were all making preparations, Sachidananda Swami and others. They had put a chair and they had tied two bamboos on the chair. And then I was surprised, there was haribari, there was just loose talks. Everyone was surprised, what is going to happen? Then Sachidananda Swami said, "Mataji called me. She wanted to go to Papa's Samadhi. The doctors have very strictly advised that Mataji should not even move. That's why she was not even going to the bathroom. She was only lying down." So Sachidananda Swami reminded to Mataji, "Mataji, I will obey, but doctor has advised you should not even get up from the bed." "Do it, Sachidananda. I want to go to Papa's shrine." That was before that also, she never made such a request. After that day also, she did not make such a request. And when I went there, already preparations were there, and they have decorated the chair with cushions and everything. And Sachidananda Swami whispered into my ears, "Mataji is going to sit on the chair. We are going to carry her to Papa's shrine. I am very nervous because doctor has said that she should not even rise up from the bed. This is very risky." I said, "When Mataji herself has said, why should we be feeling tension or worried about it? She will take care of everything." And Mataji was lifted and brought and put on the chair. She whispered to Sachidananda Swami something. Sachidananda Swami came. I was standing behind. He said, "Mataji says you should carry her first in the right hand side. Don't take it as a humor. It is not simple repetition or anything. This is the grace of your guru. They know what is lacking, what is needed." So Sachidananda Swami said, "Come back. Don't be behind. Come in the front. Mataji has said you have to carry on the right hand side. First person you have to carry." And I obeyed. And I did not have any thought about it. I did not even connect it with what is will be happening in Ramanashram. I took it as an independent incident.